Hello everyone, welcome back to YK Reviews. First of all, Happy New Year. Hope everyone had a good one and hopefully everything that you're looking for in 2023 does come true. This today is going to be about Marvel Phase 3, the tier ranking. I done the Marvel Phase 4 back in November. Link will be somewhere up here. I'm going to be doing the phases, Phase 4, 3, 2, 1 in the build-up leading up to Ant-Man 3 Quantumania in February, where we begin Phase 5. So with this, let's get into it. Now with Marvel Phase 3, this is essentially the end of the Infinity Saga, and when you compare Phase 4 to Phase 3, it's for me night and day. There was really, really great stuff in Marvel Phase 3, and with this, it was only just movie-based. So Phase 3, just movies coming out every year, rather than Phase 4 where you had Disney Plus shows, Marvel movies, and special presentations. This strictly was just three to four movies every single year. So you have that time frame to build up the storylines, build up the Infinity Saga. But without further ado, let's get into this here. As you can see on the screen, we've got all 11 movies from Phase 3. And right off the bat, I'm just going to start off with, for me, my favorite Marvel movie in all of the MCU timeline here. With this one, Marvel Avengers Endgame. And I'm just going to say with this right off the bat, this, for me, is an A triple plus. Like, this was the perfect ending to the Infinity Saga. The way that they wrapped up the storylines, the 5-year time jump, the character development. You think that all hope is lost, especially in the first part of the movie when they chop off Thanos' head. Infinity Stones are shattered. 5 years later have passed, and it's just the way they have like these characters with like Captain America, Iron Man, you have Scott Lang coming back. And then what really elevates this movie for me personally was the reaction inside the theater when you've got like the time heist and like everybody going off in different directions, and you have like just storylines being wrapped up with like certain like characters, like for example Iron Man and like his journey, Captain America and his journey, Natasha and her journey, and then the portal scenes with everybody just returning. Like, I remember like the reaction in the movie theater was just something I've not experienced in a long, long time. So for me personally, it's just a fantastic movie, and I've seen this many, many times since it has been released. I watched it about a month ago. There was like a power outage in my area. I didn't have any power, so no Wi-Fi or anything like that. So I used the data on my phone to watch this, since I had no power whatsoever inside the house. So I just ended up watching this movie again. It's just, that for me is just the perfect ending to a saga, perfect Avengers movie, great final battle, great third act. And then the ending too, with like the death of Iron Man, Captain America getting old, the death of Natasha, Thor going his like separate ways, Hulk, and just you had these core characters, and just everything about it was just perfectly done. So for me, Avengers Endgame is up there as like the A triple plus, S tier, whatever you want to call it. Great, great Marvel movie. And then the predecessor for this movie, Avengers Infinity War. Once again, same ranking for me. This is going S tier, A triple plus, top of the movie chains. These two movies back to back are one of the most best written Marvel movies they have done. Like, just from whatever happened in like the previous movies, and we'll get onto that with, especially with Captain America Civil War, like you have all these heroes spread out, separated. You've got the Guardians with Thor, you've got Captain America, Black Panther, Natasha, Vision in one section, Doctor Strange, Iron Man, Spider-Man in one particular area. Like, you've got these three separate storylines going on. You see Thanos' like journey in collecting all of the Infinity Stones and the battles that takes place in every single like part of the movie was just really fantastic, really well written, really, really well choreographed too. And there's even just some epic moments too, like for example, Thor just landing in Wakanda and the music, the camera work, the effects, just all of that playing out. Was just made for great cinema. And then the ending of the movie with Thanos doing what he said he's going to do, snapped his fingers, half the universe disappearing. You have this great conflict and you just, like, the ending of the movie leaves you in, like, holy shit mode. So for me, these two movies are probably the epitome of Marvel movies, the top ranking movies. And it's like, this is where you have to, like, this is a glass ceiling for them, and this is where the other movies are trying to reach. But for me, just such fantastic movies back to back too. So for me, top tier, both of these movies here. And so next up on the list here, we've got Guardians of the Galaxy Volume 2. Now, with Guardians of the Galaxy Volume 1, and I will get to that at the time of like the tier ranking for Phase 2. For me, Volume 2, is a slight stepping stone versus Volume 1. Like, Volume 1 had a really great storyline, great build-up, the characters, the story arcs, just was really well developed. With this one, they had some good character arcs. Yondu's character arc throughout the movie was so well written and really emotional towards the ending. This obviously is going to be a spoiler review of all the movies. So if you haven't seen any of the movies, this is just a quick warning here. This is all spoiler reviews. But with Yondu's character arc, the death at the end for him was just such well-written, well-placed scenes. And with like the Ravagers spread across the galaxy there, his funeral was a really, really nice touch and a really great way to send off Yondu. But in terms of like the villain itself, like Ego, the Living Planet, I feel like his storyline was a little bit weak. The movie overall is a fun watch. It's got that rewatchable factor. I've seen the movie maybe 4 or 5 times now. It really is a fun movie to watch. But when you compare Volume 1 versus Volume 2, I have to say that the first one was so much better than this one. I like the introduction of Mantis being involved with Batista's character Drax. Just was hilarious. The little slight interactions between Gamora and Star-Lord, like hinting at like their relationship, developing their characters and their relationship together as well, was really nicely done. And in terms of like Rocket, Groot, their characters and their like interactions, their sequences, was a fun watch to me. I had a great time with it. But when it comes to like the pushing of like the third act, the pushing of like Ego's intentions and what like he is wanting to do, his plans, and it just for me felt a little flat. And even like the ending as well, when it comes to like them defeating Ego, I just felt like it could have been a lot more stronger. So for me, when it comes to Guardians of the Galaxy Volume 2, I'm gonna have to put this at a low B, like B minus for me, just because I felt like it could have been a lot stronger, because Volume 1 was a really fantastic movie. A lot of people thought this wouldn't work, but we'll get into all of that at the time of when we discussed Volume 1. But yeah, Volume 2, just a little bit of a step down in my personal preference. So for me, this is a B minus here. Now, next up on the list here is we've got Thor Ragnarok. So Thor and Thor the Dark World. Like, the Dark World was a huge step down from the original Thor movie. The characters, the villain was just very bland. Once again, I'll get into all of that when it comes to the time of discussing that movie. But so then when Taika Waititi took over and developed Thor Ragnarok, I felt like this was such a huge boost compared to like the Dark World, just in terms of like characters, in terms of storyline, in terms of visually the colors, just blasting great colors, great visual concept, and like a complete U-turn from the Thor Dark World movie. That was more of like a dark setting, colors was just bland and dull, and then you had this one where it's just vibrant and bright and just a fun like watch. And so you've got Hela as a villain, you've got Loki and Thor together, and the comedy in this, because as I mentioned, Thor Love and Thunder was just brutal to watch. I tried rewatching it, and I'll be completely honest, it was very hard to just finish the movie. I've seen so many people put Thor Love and Thunder in their bottom of the worst movies of 2022. So for Thor Ragnarok, this, I just don't understand how it went so downhill after that. But when it comes to this movie in particular, the comedy was perfect. Like, it wasn't too much like Screaming Goats or just a love triangle with Mjolnir and the axe. This comedy here, the timing with, like, you've got Hulk, you've got Valkyrie, you've got Loki, the Grandmaster, like, everything was just really well developed and timed very well. When it comes to, like, the serious tone versus a comedy tone, it was done really well. And some of the lines, too, were just hilarious.
This planet.
Hey! Hey! We know each other! He's a friend from work! Loki? Loki's alive. Can you believe it? He's up there. Loki! Look who it is!
When it comes to like Thor versus Hulk in the Battle of Champions, really great sequences. And the third act too, the final battle, really well done here. My only criticism for this movie was Hela killing off the warriors that protect Asgard. Just a complete waste of like those characters. And I really enjoyed those characters in the first two movies. So to have them just get killed off like this so easily too was very disappointing. But in terms of overall with this movie, this is probably the best movie in the Thor franchise in itself. So for me, I'm going to have to give Thor Ragnarok an A. This for me was a very fun watch, a really great movie, well written. The death of Odin was really heartbreaking, having to see Doctor Strange making that small appearances, but then you have that relationship between Loki and Thor, like the two of them are just hilarious together. I really enjoyed their sequences, their scenes together. It was just really fun. The snake story as well just cracked me up. So I really loved this movie. So Thor Ragnarok is going as an A. And so next up on the list here is we've got Captain America Civil War, basically the start of Phase 3. And for me, what I mentioned earlier with Endgame and Infinity War, this sort of like kicked off everything, the chain reaction to why Thanos was able to like collect all the Infinity Stones, delete half the universe. The beginning of the movie and the build up as the movie is progressing, the introduction of Black Panther, you've got Zemo being the main antagonist of the movie, and then obviously that airport sequences, the airport scene with Captain America versus Iron Man and the rest of the characters. I really had a fun time with this movie. And then you've got Bucky and Steve Rogers versus Iron Man. That fight sequence too is just so iconic. Like the Iron Man blasting from his chest with the shield, the two of them working together in like some 2-on-1 handicap match. I had such a great time with this. And the way the storyline was written with the Soviet Accords, just everything made sense when it comes to like the plot. And the villain of the movie too. Like, it wasn't some cosmic villain. It wasn't somebody trying to like destroy the planet or anything like that. This genuinely had somebody who had a gripe with the Avengers after what happened in Avengers Age of Ultron. So this was a perfect movie, a really great mini Avengers type movie, and a really great build up and a kickoff to Phase 3 and what led to Thanos. So for me, when it comes to Captain America Civil War, this one is also going to go as like an A. A really great movie here. And once again, that airport sequence, Hawkeye versus Natasha, Ant-Man, Bucky, Falcon versus Vision and War Machine and Spider-Man 2 was just really, really great. So I really love this movie here. And next up on the list here is we've got Captain Marvel. I'll be completely honest, I did not watch this movie until probably like when COVID started, I think. Like, I watched Avengers Endgame, Infinity War, stuff like that, and then it was in the middle of the pandemic. I was literally sitting in the living room thinking to myself, you know what, I've not seen Captain Marvel yet. Maybe I'll put it on, check it out, see what's going on here. And the one positive I have is Coulson and Nick Fury, like a younger version of themselves. They had a really great role in the movie in itself. Like, I really like their characters and what they did, but the plot of like Carol Danvers losing her memory, having amnesia, having people tell her like what she is or what to do, and just, I've seen a lot of criticisms of this movie, and it's understandable criticism. I just felt like this movie could have been a lot stronger, a way to like build up, because when she made her appearances in Endgame, she was this really powerful character. You could have built on that in the movie itself, shown the kind of person she is, shown the kind of superhero she is, this really strong, powerful superhero. But instead, they went for the route of where she's got amnesia, she's sort of like not knowing what the hell's going on, what the hell's happening, only for the end of the movie, she just like beats a villain easily. It's just, I felt like the dialogue was very poor, the storyline was very poor, the writing in this just wasn't really that powerful or that strong. So I think like this is one of the weakest movies in the Infinity Saga, and especially in Phase 3. So for me, when it comes to Captain Marvel, I'm giving this one an F+. Like, I don't want to put it as like the worst movie in Marvel, because it's definitely not. But in terms of Phase 3, it's probably the worst one there. And so next up on the list here is we've got Black Panther, the original Black Panther. And this one, sadly, is the only one with Chadwick Boseman in it. Obviously, I've done the review of Black Panther Wakanda Forever. Link will be somewhere up here also. It's also on the channel too, so definitely check that out if you get the chance. But when it comes to Black Panther, this, for me, was one of the strongest MCU movies here. Like, the villain Killmonger, played by Michael B. Jordan, was probably the best villain, aside from Thanos, obviously, like, the best villain they've done in the Marvel Cinematic Universe. It was such a shame to see him get killed off, because of how strong of a villain he is. You kind of, like, rooted for him. You kind of understood where he was coming from. This wasn't somebody that just wants to, like, take over Wakanda for the sake of taking over. You get his gripes, you get his like intentions, you understand where he's coming from. And having him versus like Black Panther was a really great sequence there. The choreograph when it comes to like the fight sequences too, when it comes to like Chadwick Boseman when he did the fight sequences in the river area in the beginning, and then also again versus Michael B. Jordan, the choreograph done there, I thought was one of the standouts in the movie. It was really well written. And in the storyline too, you've got the backstory when it comes to like Killmonger and Chadwick Boseman's Black Panther in the beginning, with like the history of their fathers, and then this all now builds up and leads up to like the second act towards the third act. So I think that what they did with this movie was fantastic, and I wish we could have seen more leading up to the sequels of the movies. However, this movie in particular is one of the strongest MCU movies there, and if you haven't seen it, I highly, highly recommend this. And it was a great introduction to the character of Black Panther. I mean, I'm not even going to talk about like what it did in terms of like the community and like everything else, because you don't need me to say that you know how much of an impact it made. And I think that it did a fantastic job starting the Black Panther character and introducing us to the MCU for Black Panther. So for me, when it comes to Black Panther, I'm giving this one an A. And so next up on the list here is we've got Doctor Strange. Again, they introduce a brand new character played by Benedict Cumberbatch, and I think he's the perfect role for Doctor Strange. When it comes to this movie, when they introduce him, he's sort of like this douchebag doctor that you don't really root for. But this character development that they build for him when he gets introduced to like the mystical world, when he starts slowly becoming Doctor Strange, I thought was one of the best written characters in the MCU so far. My only criticisms that I have here is that the villain, Caecilius, I think his name was, just wasn't that strong of a villain to begin with, to be honest with you. I really enjoyed Dormammu, and like, I thought it was a great way, a clever way of like defeating Dormammu with Doctor Strange at the end. But just like that build up, I really liked the introduction of the Ancient One. Wong was a great introduction, and I really liked that little back and forth they had. The comedy of that was really well placed, but the villain just really wasn't that memorable or great. However, they do have one of the best sequences visually when it comes to like the visual effects and Doctor Strange going through like this loop of like interdimensional stuff. If you've seen the movie, you know what I'm talking about. And also the mirror sequence too. Like, I thought that was one of the best scenes in Phase 3 when it comes to like that mirror sequences. It was so well done and visually stunning to look at, and like mind-blowing too, because it does remind you of Inception. So you have to give praise to that, and you have to give praise to like the characters, like I mentioned, Ancient One, Wong, Mordu. But the villain just kind of had that letdown for me. So I think Doctor Strange was a fantastic entry into the MCU and into Phase 3. And overall, is a rewatchable movie, fun movie. If I'm comparing it to Multiverse of Madness, I think that this one just edges it ever so slightly. Doctor Strange 2 is a fun watch. I had a good time with it. My only criticism is that it just, that horror element was great, but there wasn't enough Multiverse of Madness, basically. And with this one, visually was great. Storyline was great. Plot was great. Villain, not so much. But for me, when it comes to Doctor Strange, I'm going to have to give this one a B. This, for me, was a fantastic entry and a really fun movie. A really strong introduction to a character solo type movie. So, yeah, Doctor Strange, B+. And next up on the list here is we've got the sequel to Ant-Man with Ant-Man and the Wasp. And I think this is probably the second worst movie in this, in the Phase 3 here. The villain just wasn't that great. Like, similar with Doctor Strange, the villain itself wasn't that great. I like the sequences with the pin particles, like the chase sequences in San Francisco with the cars is a great watch. However, I just feel like it could have been a lot stronger in terms of like the plot of the movie. Ghost just, for me, just felt very flat. I liked the third act. The third act was a lot stronger than the rest of the movie, but I just feel like this movie could have been so much better. It had a lot of potential. It just felt very flat. A lot of people are like criticizing the movie too when it comes to like the villain as well, because it just felt like you could have built it up a lot stronger, had a more interesting villain, or just did something different with it. But instead they went with the route of like trying to save Ghost and like the I can't even remember the guy's name, the one that did the exchange, and then you had that little like sequences at the restaurant with the salt pepper going from miniature size to a big size, like that person. I just didn't like that. But once again, I like the car chase sequences with like the cars going big to small. Having a little building in a suitcase was very clever, but just couldn't do much with it. So yeah, when it comes to like Ant-Man and the Wasp, for me, I'm gonna have to give this one a D plus. Just felt like it, like I said, it could have been a lot stronger. Not the best in the Ant-Man franchise. If you're comparing both, Ant-Man 1 is so much stronger than this one. So yeah, this one is a D for me here. And then we get to like the final two entries into Phase 3, and both are Spider-Man. So you've got the first one and then the second one. So with Spider-Man Homecoming, you get introduced to Tom Holland's Spider-Man in Civil War. And I really liked his character. He's like a fun, bubbly personality. We get to see him in the beginning phases of him being Spider-Man in Spider-Man Homecoming, doing the friendly neighborhood Spider-Man. I think they did a fantastic job with the way they wrote it, with the way they wrote this character with Tom Holland, having that introduction of Iron Man, Robert Downey Jr.'s Iron Man inside this movie too. Felt like it elevated it a lot slightly. Him being in high school too, getting the introduction to like Ned, and also the big villain, the Vulture, played by Michael Keaton, I think was one of the best villains in the Spider-Man franchise too. Like, Michael Keaton did a fantastic job. I really liked what they did with this movie, and for me, that sequence is when he's stuck under the building and you have that little like lift moment of him like realizing how strong he is as Spider-Man emotionally and physically. to then going on to like beating the Vulture by but not like killing him or doing anything like that, but the way he like defeated the Vulture was perfect way to write how Spider-Man would be. So I really, really like this entrance, and even that conflict, especially with him versus Iron Man, when that whole boat sequences appeared and then you have that little interaction between the two of them, I think was really well written. So for me, when it comes to Spider-Man Homecoming, I think this one is a fantastic entry, a fantastic kickoff to that three Spider-Man trilogy. So for me, when it comes to Spider-Man Homecoming, I'm giving this one a. I think this was a fantastically kicked off Spider-Man trilogy movie. Really, really well written, really well directed. A fantastic entry here. And the final one on the list here is we've got Spider-Man Far From Home, the sequel to Spider-Man Homecoming, and the first movie since Endgame. So you sort of see Tom Holland, he's just fought with the Avengers. He's sort of like facing the consequences after Iron Man had passed away. So you get that internal conflict that he's having to go through, and you get to see him sort of being manipulated by Mysterio. Jake Gyllenhaal did a really fantastic job with playing Mysterio. His character, I feel like, elevated the movie too. Slightly weaker than Homecoming in terms of like the plot and like the reason as to why like Mysterio needs the glasses, basically the Edith glasses that Iron Man just gave to a kid. I just felt like didn't make any sense and could have been written a lot better. However, when it comes to like the actual movie, I think it was a fun watch. I think it was a fantastic movie. I think it's not the best one out of the three trilogies. I feel like No Way Home is up there as number one, Homecoming second, and this one is the third one, as it's just like a slightly weaker story plot device of like the reason as to why Mysterio did what he did and how he was able to do everything. That for me was just a little bit weak. However, the action sequences, the drone sequences, the Mysterio mind trickery, I think was fantastic. And the visual effects, the directing, the choreographing fight sequences is one of the stronger ones in the Spider-Man trilogy. And then also that WTF moment at the end of the movie, the return of J. Jonah Jameson's, I think was really fun.
There you have it, folks. Conclusive proof that Spider-Man was responsible for the brutal murder of Mysterio, an interdimensional warrior who gave his life to protect our planet and who will no doubt go down in history as the greatest superhero of all time. But that's not all, folks. Here's the real blockbuster. Brace yourselves. You might want to sit down.
Spider-Man's name is Peter Parker.
What the?
And a great, great ending to the movie in itself because of what happens in the next movie. However, when it comes to Spider-Man No Way Home, for me, I'm going to give this one like a B minus, because overall, it just was the weaker of the three movies there. But this is my list when it comes to Marvel Phase 3. There's maybe some that you agree with, some that you disagree with. Let me know down in the comment section below. This is going to be the overall list, however, though. So please let me know what your thoughts and your opinions are in the comment section down below here. Like I mentioned, I did a Phase 4 last month, so the link will be somewhere around here. Check out the channel so that you can check out Phase 4. I'll be doing Phase 2 in the next couple of weeks, as once again I mentioned, we're building up towards Ant-Man 3 Quantumania when it comes to Marvel Phase 5, the kickoff to Marvel Phase 5. So keep an eye out on the channel, hit the subscribe button, like button, hit the notification bell so that you don't miss out on any future videos. I'll be posting a lot more now that I'm back to like 100% full health, so keep an eye out on the channel there. But thank you so much for watching, thank you so much for listening. I have got a Twitter, link is in the description down below. Go check me out there. And once again, Happy New Year. Peace.